Hey, what's up, everybody? Adam.
Hey, Kirk, what's doing, my man?
Nothing much, brother.
Great to see you.
Yeah, good. Well, good to see you too. You look like you lost some weight.
I did lose weight. Don't tell nobody.
Looking good, looking good.
Thanks, money. Appreciate that, my man.
So, you want to know what this is that I got going on in
Yeah,
the screen here?
school me up. School me up. It's great to be hanging with you. What are you drawing?
This is a Luxura cover. This is a Luxura cover. It's for one of two books. I'm not exactly sure which one yet,
Okay.
but this was an older image that I penciled. I think I penciled it last year and just never got around to finishing it. And I like how the image looked. I like the flow of the hair
Yeah, it's excellent. It's nice
and
composition.
everything like that. So I know I got some books coming up that I'm working on, so I want to go ahead and finish this. I would go in and like mess with it and noodle with it here and there, but now I'm trying to get down to the final.
That's blue pencil, but that's or is that's not digital. Like the inks are digital, right?
The inks are digital. Pencils were not. I did the pencils traditionally.
Okay.
I've done both, where I've inked, excuse me, where I've penciled digitally and also penciled traditionally. And there's, I guess I just need a few more years or hours of practice
Okay, messing
with
with it.
the digital. Yeah, I've got pieces out there that I penciled digitally, and to the average person, you couldn't tell the difference. But
Okay.
I can tell the difference in certain
To
little subtle ways.
the highly skilled,
Yeah, I can tell the difference
such as yourself, you can see the difference.
in certain, yeah, you know, certain ways I can see the difference. And hang on.
You don't like the difference.
No, well, no, I like the difference. It works. The only thing is there are just some things that I learned how to do with a pencil
Okay.
for penciling for, you know, most of my life.
Gotcha.
That to get the Wacom tool to do the same thing that I want to do in the pencil,
Okay.
sometimes, you know, I got to kind of do things differently. There's actually some strokes that the way you do it traditionally on paper is different than how you would do it in digitally.
Interesting.
But yeah, it is. It was quite a learning curve for me. I got into digital inking and penciling a bunch of years ago. I don't know, maybe 3 or 4. Yeah, 3 or 4. I was 3 or 4 years, maybe a little more, when I got my first Wacom tablet. And you know, I was screwing around with it, and then I had a job that I had to do. And so what I did was I just kind of dived in and used the Wacom tablet to do it digitally and just kind of throw myself in at the deep end and figure it all out. And it came out good. I was really surprised there were so many differences digitally than working traditionally. And you know, it's really wild because, I mean, here, let me show you. If you look at the screen now, you know, whatever, if my hand slips,
You could undo really
yeah,
easily.
you could just
Oh,
undo,
that's yeah.
you know,
Can't
you
do
could,
that with a black
yeah. So,
ink.
you know, if I'm
Yeah.
inking this eye and I do like one of these, it's like, if this were
Ooh.
traditional, it's over.
Yeah.
You know, this piece is
Throw it
done, but I
away.
hit the undo button, and then, you know,
I gotcha. Never happened. Like it never even happened, as
like
the
it never
expression
happened. You
goes.
know, I can do all of this here, and like, you know, that's, my God, that's a disaster. This art is
Don't
ruined.
do that.
I know, even now that I know I can do it, it's like,
It's still a terrible feeling. Well,
yeah,
you
it's
could
a
offer
rough one.
that at a discount on eBay if people want
Yeah,
to buy that
right.
digital.
Yeah.
That's wild.
And the best way that I could describe it is the feeling the feeling is that you can pencil with ink. Mm. So it.
Because you can correct it, right?
Yeah, because you can go ahead and correct it.
That's wild.
Yeah.
So you, as you've inked over the years, well, never even occurred to me because I'm the publishing end more than the, brass tacks producing pages and, but if you're an inker, inking someone else's pencils, like, good God, you got to really pay attention, huh?
Oh yeah, that's why, years gone by, a really good inker is worth their weight in gold. Mm. I mean, there's a reason why, you'll see Jim Lee's only using Scott Williams, it's because he knows that he'll get. I mean, traditional inking on paper is really, it's really a craft. Mm. It is a craft that, took me years to try to become proficient and master it. And, it served me well because being that I pencil my own stuff, I don't have to worry if I can't find an inker. I can't find an inker to do it, I'll ink it myself. I mean, remember back in the day when we were at Personality?
Yeah, a couple of years ago.
And we were doing spoof comics, and we had for the Spider-Femme story, we hired Henry Martinez, and he sent in his pencils, and they were really beautiful, they were really good. And I was like, Adam, there's nobody in the studio that can ink this. I'm gonna have to ink this myself.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah.
So that first Spider-Femme story in Spoof Comics was penciled by Henry and inked by me. Because at the time, we didn't have anybody in the studio who...
could do that level.
Yeah, it could do that level. We just didn't.
Pretty...
Pretty cool. What do you call it? The amazing swimsuit cover that Adam Hughes did. Mm. And I had to finish the inks.
I had that laying around, and I was looking at the coloring that we ultimately did. It's like,
yeah, that was beautiful.
The inking was great. The inking was really, really great on it.
Yeah, great coloring too. The recolored version.
The recolored version. the original version is like, it's not as great. I'll grab it one second.
Yeah, the original version I colored. That's my coloring. And as you can see, my coloring was not. let's say it was sufficient, but
no, it wasn't. It's not even sufficient for flat.
It's not going to win any awards.
Well, the inks are great, but
yeah, but the colors are just flat colors.
Colors, yeah, you can tell the ones that, even the ones that Adam colored with, I don't know what he was doing, what media he was using for the other covers for Spoof.
Yeah, I don't remember.
Crazy. It was, but the inks are nice as hell. Yeah, we got to do some fun stuff back in the day. Now it's all about fun stuff now. So you just wrapped up that campaign. It looks like it did really well.
Yeah, it did pretty good. Here, I'll see if I can show it, go back and get it on screen here.
Cool.
Where are you? Okay, I have to stop sharing this.
Right? You know what? I can send you a link.
Wait, hang on. I'll stop sharing that, and then I will share. I don't know which one am I sharing. This one. Are you seeing? You got
That's
it.
What I was talking about. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Looking good.
So yeah, that was you know, it was a nice little, quick little fun 10-day campaign.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the Luxura trade paperbacks that I have, 10 of them. And I wanted to add some new covers. So we did see here this Slave Girl Luxura cover.
Star Wars, right?
Yeah. And also the Naughty cover. So if you're going down here, see, we got the Naughty one.
Mm-hmm.
Recolored and remastered.
Is that the first nude cover for the trade paperbacks?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Of course. Cool. I didn't do any in the original release. And then a good friend of mine did the artwork for the Slave Girl. Every time I look at this image, I get, you know, I hear the music. Dun, 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 dun.
Nothing like mixing her up in Star Wars.
Yeah.
It's pretty damn cool.
It's a lot of fun. A lot of fun.
Did you direct much of that cover, or did you just like
I directed nothing. I just said, hey, can you put Luxura in Star Wars? And he went and did it.
Okay. Nice.
Didn't do anything. And then we had the house.
So hopefully you'll do. Yeah, I really like that cover.
Yeah, thanks. This is actually acrylic paint, airbrush, and ink on illustration board.
So that's not digital?
No, there is no digital work
here. Oh, wow. Well, you really would have
all of this digital. Is all hand. Everything you see here is hand drawn, with exception of logos.
Wow.
Let me go down to the, yeah.
These books are not available anymore, by the way, right? Because the campaign's over, or are you going to be able to make them available to people?
Well, yeah, you could actually get it in the next campaign.
Okay.
Yeah. You can get it in the next campaign.
Okay. So if somebody's watching this and they want it, they can get it from the next stuff you launch.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. Actually, let's see. But yeah, this is all by hand. There's no digital in this whatsoever.
It really looks digital to me. That's amazing.
Digital.
Yeah. Such bright colors. I guess that's what acrylics are all about, huh?
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. And actually, I'm going to be launching the next volume to this. I think within a couple of days, maybe a week.
Cool. Are you going to continue the Star Wars variant theme?
No, what I'm doing is I'm doing different variants. Hang on, I'll give you a sneak peek.
All right, a little sneaky.
Now it's asking me to put in a password.
Well, it should. Okay.
Yeah.
I don't want to do too much of that publicly.
Let me see. What can I do here? What would be the best way to do this?
So no trouble with Kickstarter? Like, they've been pretty cool to work with?
Yeah, man, I'm fine. I've done, I don't know how many campaigns I've done. All right, well, maybe next time we stream, I'll show you the other one.
Okay.
But I've done, I'd like to say 20 campaigns or something like that.
20 and change, cool.
Yeah, and they've all, Kickstarter's pretty easy to work with.
Yeah, nice.
Pretty easy to work with.
Pretty nice. So you'll get that cover done.
Uh-huh.
And then you just have to figure out which book you want to put that on.
Yeah, well, there's... I actually know what, like, the next 5 to 10 books are that I'm going to do. And
excellent.
Sometimes, when I take a look at the book and I look at what's inside and how everything is coming together, sometimes I'll switch up and say, I think I'll put this cover on this book.
Mm.
Sometimes, most of the time, I know this one's exactly for that one. This is exactly for this one. But, every so often, I'll do an image, and if like, if it's an image that I really, really like, I might save it for a special project.
Sure. Or you see it and you say, you know what, this would be perfect for that. Like you and I were talking about artists before and different projects I'm planning and whatnot. And she's like, you know what, this guy seems like he'd be good for this. In the meantime, he's working on something else. And it's like, you know, that's just part of, it's not done until it's all, you know, put together. And then it's like, okay, this is great. You know, you can, you know, when you have a hit, try to put it out and try to get a hit every time. If we can make the stuff people like.
Yeah. So you got some cool stuff coming down the pipe?
That's what it looks like, my friend. I have this superhero character I'm working on, and just got somebody doing a test, and he's really, really good. He's one of the best people I've ever hired to do work. Yeah, nice. Really, really neat. So we'll see. And he seems to have a great attitude. And you know, you kind of also, I find just like working with people, if you do a little test, you kind of get a dynamic of, you know, is this person reasonable to work with? Are you a good fit for them?
Right.
And sometimes it's just like people are great. It's just that what they're, but the way they're used to working, you can't accommodate it. You know, so far so good. And I really like this guy's professionalism. They have another guy who's doing character designs. And then I want to find, I have to reach out to a friend of mine who's worked with this artist who's done some, well, he's done a lot of animation. He likes comics, and he's doing some comics, but he's really very good at like Saturday morning cartoon type of stuff.
Oh, cool.
Oh, yeah. I know he's done that like professional animation for that. Uh-huh. And he's in Mexico. So they work fast. I don't know. But he's in Mexico. Yeah, no, I've talked to him before. It was on a live stream with him a couple months ago, and he was looking for work then. But there's a friend of mine who's done some work with him recently. So I want to reach out to my friend and say, hey, how did that go? Which is why, you know, if there's anybody that are creators that are looking, you know, or publishers, you know, that are listening to this, it is always good to try to leave relationships on a high note where you can, you know, and then if something, you know, just to have a good understanding, because people do talk about each other. And we need to do that. You know, we need to know it's, you know, this is someone who people say good things about. So I have to understand. First of all, if he's not too busy helping my friend's project right now, which I wouldn't interfere with that. But he probably won't be, because I don't have an immediate short-term deadline to deal with or anything like that. But yeah, he'd be great for G.I. Jackrabbits is what I'm thinking. Particularly like if he can do some, I have the character designs that I like for G.I. Jackrabbits, but they need work. So if this guy is really good with design, and I'm getting a sense that he is, then he could take it to the next level, and then we can really do a really, really great looking project. So yeah, I like the collaboration and the communication. And one of the things I like the most is to see new things come out of a project because you're working with a real strong talent, you know. And you want people to take ownership of things, right?
Right.
You know, so you want to give them a chance to contribute, especially when it comes to things that they're really, really good at. So yeah, it's very cool to see an idea come to life, and to get in that good working dynamic where, you know, what you contribute is good and what they contribute is good, and then every now and then people have a breakthrough, which is why I think it's harder for people that try to do things completely all on their own. You know, because everybody's got one great idea every now and then. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, so if you're working with a creative team, a writer, a colorist, usually now it's pencil and inking together, but different people can suggest different things. And, you know,
you can... I'm just checking. Am I sharing the screen with the art?
Yeah.
What do you get? Yep.
I'm seeing the art up.
Oh, okay. All right.
Somebody's inking something. It looks like you.
Okay, cool. Yeah,
go ahead. Absolutely. So yeah, this is it's a lot of fun working with a creative team. I really like it. Some of the best work that way. You know, I was noticing on Kickstarter too. I'm like, okay, there's some of these people are doing like 15 covers or 20 covers or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
And oh, I get, were you going to say?
Yeah, go ahead. No,
no, I was going to say, I guess you really kind of start to see, because if you're on social media as well and you see these artists, they are usually promoting the projects that they are doing work on. So right. I guess if you've got like 10 artists that have a following and they're going to help promote the books.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, this, and then if it's not just that the people that they're, it's not just that the individual artists that are promoting it on a sell to just their following, they'll also, you know, bring somebody in who will probably buy other covers as well.
Right. Yeah.
Though, I mean, just looking at all of it, it's like, I've done a lot of covers before, but these guys have me beat. I think I've done as many as 6 covers at a time for, you know, for a comic store version of a cover. But your current campaign had 6 covers, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Current one had 6 covers. Mm-hmm.
So it's something to think about. Do you think people are really into the no logo Virgin covers?
Yeah, definitely.
They like that as a variant?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hmm. It did well on the last campaign that I did.
Wow. Do they buy both or?
Yeah.
Okay.
They'll buy both. They'll buy. There are some people who will collect all of the covers.
Mm.
You know, it runs the spectrum from people who buy every single cover to others who will just buy one or two. You know, it's just, it depends on the individual.
Interesting. Yeah, now it's a little bit more affordable as a publisher to do an extra cover like that.
Yeah, definitely.
Back in the day, we would have had to put up a little bit more money for that extra plate change. And
yeah, pretty expensive.
The setup is still, obviously all the setup takes effort, and every time you have a new thing to deal with, you have to make sure there are no mistakes and all that. Uh-huh. So it's not like it's nothing to produce an extra cover, but 6 is very modest. It's like that's pretty great
these days, right?
But that's what you'd say is like, well, even for the mainstream companies, they're doing like 50 covers sometimes on a book.
Yeah,
it's like a lot of covers. Yeah. I know Dynamite like has issue number 5 out of Red Sonja or whatever, and they've got like 6, 7, 8 covers. Like,
yeah, I mean, I think it's fun to collect, you know.
Yeah, I if they're good, why not?
Right. Yeah.
Because you could do, I was thinking this for a character, you can do, you know, for a typical superhero, whatever, you can do a regular cover, you can do a manga cover, you can do, I ought to write these down so I don't forget them, yeah. But I'm searched around to see what it was. But I guess this is for a female character. So this has been a nude cover, a manga cover, the regular cover. You know, different subject matter covers. And what's kind of amazing is there are just so many special covers around now that there's a lot of reference to.
Yeah.
You know, where you could just be like, all right, well, let me go to Mike DiBalfo's page, Scott Campbell's page, any number of these guys, and look at like what I find most iconic about what they've done, and then do even a similar, you know, concept for designing. Well, I was in Facebook, I think, and I'm part of a group that's like a pinup artist support group or something like that. Like, not for emotional problems, but like they share reference and things like that for composition.
Pinup artist support group.
Yeah, it's like a support group. They help each other out. But it was something like they're sharing out resources for reference for poses and things like that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, which is, you know, it's funny because social media is it's bad in a lot of ways, but you know, if you figure, it's like a tool like anything else, you just kind of figure out like what works. You know, I've been looking for artists lately, so I've been in Facebook and then linking off to DeviantArt and ArtStation. I think I was telling you DeviantArt, the way they, like, you can tag your art as an artist,
yes,
with different relevant categories, and then you can search those tags. Like, right. I want every Zenoscope tagged artist or Action Lab or, you know, any number of things like that. And mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Comes right up. Comes right up. So yeah, another back in the day, like prior internet, it was not that easy to find artists. No. You couldn't say, you know what, I'm going to spend an hour and go see who I can find online and look at their portfolios. You know, it was just ad and comic buyer's guide, and they would, people have to mail in photocopies of their work.
Yeah, well, I ran ads and comic buyer's guide for artists back in the day, and I got great results.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we get tons of submissions.
Yeah. Yeah, it worked.
Yeah,
it worked. But there's, it's a community now too. So it's sort of like, you know, you get to work with people, and then I'm sure as you get working with a few more of those people, there's people looking for work, you know, so
yeah,
word gets out that you're looking, and, you know, they'll start hitting up. But yeah, it's a great time to be publishing. That's for sure. I'm psyched about publishing.
Are you certain about your next project, or you got a couple that you're working on?
Well, I do have a couple that I'm working on. And I am certain that the next project is going to be this female superhero. But I don't know when I can launch the project yet, as I have to nail down all the production elements from the final character design to the interior art and coloring and the final look of all of it and all that. And, you know, it's like, I'm looking to do a project that I'm going to probably spend 6 months promoting and overseeing and putting a lot of time into it. So it's, there's a lot of commitment to that project. So you just want to make sure everything is really right. But I do miss putting out projects a little bit more easily and casually. Yeah, more frequently is necessary, because you're not a publisher unless you're publishing. And it definitely doesn't pay unless you publish. You know, if you want to make money publishing, you got to publish.
Yeah.
that's seems simple, but it's true. It's simple. So, yeah, I'm thinking about creating kind of a second track for publishing, where I can do some other smaller projects that aren't necessarily, because, you know, from publishing for a few years, let's just say, you get a lot of ideas of things you want to do, maybe things to bring back. I was talking with somebody about bringing back Chromium Man, and I have a great story for Chromium Man, where I put him on Earth. He's originally on another planet outside of Earth. And, you know, but each one of these projects, it just depending on the budget and how much effort's going to go into each one of them, it just has to be kind of timed out and planned out.
Right.
But I like small, I like the idea of doing smaller projects as well, because it's just so crucial to have regular relationships with creators and to always be looking for creators.
Yeah.
You can't really do it. Unfortunately, you know, creators, there can always be a problem. You can become, if it's an important project, you can be very dependent on that creator. And if something happens, that can ruin the project or cause you to lose a lot of money, have to replace the creator. But there can be amazing creators that can contribute so much. And, you know, it's also nice to give people work.
Yeah.
You know, it's just good because people kind of, need it, and some people aren't good at marketing themselves.
There's a guy that I'm working with now. He's been trying to work with me for over 10 years.
Oh, wow. And
we finally got into a situation where we could work on something. So
that's great.
Yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good feeling. You know, make that connection, and, you know, they get paid, they get another portfolio piece.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's good for them, good for us. You know, on to the next. And the other thing too is, you don't learn by talking about doing stuff, right? You learn by doing stuff. And then you're like, oh, gee, I didn't really realize that. You know, even I've been researching Kickstarter more. Even these name cover people, like, yeah, I know that at least back to Brian Polito's initial launches, it's something he's done forever with Lady Death, is used people with names and a following to market his brand and also lend credibility to it.
Actually, Brian does both. I worked with Brian several times. I worked with him with Chaos. I also did a cover for him for one of the Kickstarters. And when he first approached me to do work, I was not well known. I didn't really have anything. I was kind of obscure. And he was at a convention and he came by and he saw my work and he was like, man, you do some really good stuff, you know. And, you know, he said, hey, I'd like you to do some pinup for me. So to his credit. Both. He works with, top name people who have followings, but he also works with a lot of newcomers that he has an eye that if he sees the artwork, he's like, hey, this is pretty good.
Yeah.
You know, he'll, you know, even if they don't have great or huge followings.
Yeah. Yeah. He will hire people that are just good.
Yeah.
And he'll hire people with a following and it works really well. But even just that aspect of it, I'm starting to understand that product category a little bit better now, where there are just certain books that, they'll attach a lot of name covers to it and they're female characters. Yeah. And, they have consistent success on Kickstarter doing that. But there's no one easy way of, okay, you just do this and then all of a sudden it works. It's like, no, you're going to have to put in a lot of work to figure out, you know, what's actually going to work for what it is you want to try to do.
Hey, you know what we have to do one night? We got to get you, me, and Ken Becker.
Yeah, Becker will jump in.
Talking about some of the some of the old days.
Becker knows that stuff very well.
Yeah,
he does. And we can get Rinkowitz as well.
Yeah, Chris,
another great guy.
Yeah,
but I'm in touch with those guys often. Chris has been helpful to this day. He's really good people.
Yeah, I gotta reach out to Ken. I haven't talked to him in a while.
Oh yeah, tell him I said hi. We text every now and then.
Yeah,
he texts me something about Trump usually, which is fine. Not a positive things. Yes, Becker likes Trump, and I like Trump. What are you gonna do? What else is cooking? So you're gonna launch the next one fairly soon.
Yeah,
it's awesome. Yeah. I want to launch projects left and right.
Possibly.
I really do. I think I won't be able to resist doing it.
And possibly I have next week. Yeah.
Oh, very nice. Because I have some Indiegogo campaigns where I have extra books. It's like, you know what? That would be pretty easy to launch on.
Yeah, I'm sure your readers and fans would like it.
Well, I don't see why not. You know, you pick up some people on Kickstarter who didn't get a chance to get it already.
Uh-huh.
So you kind of share it out a little bit to some other people. I think it's a pretty reasonable thing to do. I don't really have it as part of a plan. So I'm just kind of trying to get my plan together and then stick to the plan and then incorporate that. Like Billy Tucci does that with She. Mm-hmm. So it seems like it makes a heck of a lot of sense because there are people that are on, well, you know, better than anybody. There are people that tend to buy through different specific platforms,
right?
You know, eBay, digital, Amazon, whatever it might be. I know before I got very heavily into Indiegogo, I always saw it as kind of odd and I never got anything on there or really messed with it all. So I think there are people that just kind of stick to both of those platforms or people stick to their individual platforms. So you kind of need to, distribution is so important. You know, we can't really take for granted that one platform is going to make sure that we can, you know, reach everybody we want to reach. I guess that's the main point.
Yeah.
That would be the main point.
All right. Well, I think that's, I've already been working on this for,
yeah,
4 or 5 hours today. So I think I'm going to call it a day for now.
Well, looks good.
Take a break.
Sounds good, my friend. A little bit of dinner, a little relaxation. Mm-hmm. Very cool. Oh, it's great being on with you. Always fun to talk. Oh, if anybody wants to check out my YouTube channel, AdamPostSpeaks.com.
Yes.
Me talking. And my favorite project is College of the Dead at collegeofthedead.com.
There you go.
Yep. Still available on Indiegogo.
All right. Okay. Well, we'll end it here. Thanks for whoever stopped by to watch, whether it was live or afterwards. And you'll be hearing from me or Adam or both of us.
We will see you again soon. And if we don't see you, we will miss you.
All right. Remember, thunder is good. Thunder is impressive. But it's lightning that does work.
All right. Now we're talking.